Hello, today we are interviewing Céline Bondard, lawyer at Paris and New York bars. Céline Bondard, welcome and thanks for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
You came today at École Polytechnique to give a conference on the topic Entrepreneur and Law, 10 Main Traps to Avoid. At École Polytechnique, we support entrepreneurship. We have a center entirely dedicated to entrepreneurship and innovation called La Fibre Entrepreneur DRAI X Innovation Center that provides startups with a spot for creation and experimentation and also dialogues with investors. In your opinion, which is the main startup's challenge in terms of business law and intellectual property today?
That's an interesting question. I could cite like many traps to avoid, and actually I'm going to talk about it for an hour and a half a bit later with the students. But I think if I had to make one main challenge, it would be to realize that the legal aspects of creating a company isn't supposed to be an issue. So a lot of startups come to me, and they come to me almost a little bit too late in the process because they think that their attorney is here to extinguish fires.
Of course. And
rather than just being there to help and create. And that's what we're doing. We're actually creating value. We're not here to say, you know, you have a problem and you shouldn't do that. We're here to find the solutions for them to do it. So the main challenge is actually to understand that, because when you actually don't, that's when you come to us a little bit too late with issues and litigation that ends up costing even more than if you didn't do the effort at the beginning. For instance, when you draft a shareholder agreement, a lot of my startups, they want to draft the shareholder agreements only when they have investors coming in, which I think is a little bit too late. It's interesting to have a shareholder agreement when you first start your company with other shareholders, because then you can understand what it's about and then agree and avoid pitfalls with your own first shareholders. And I think that's a virtuous system. So that's one instance. Another instance is if you register a trademark and then they tend to just go and register it without doing any prior research, and they come to me when they have litigation or third party saying, actually, this is kind of mine. And that's when they have problems that we could have very easily avoided just by having like an hour conversation. So the main challenge would be to actually understand that we're here for that, and it's actually important, and it's not like the last thing you should be taking care of. Yeah.
And so you just mentioned the startups you work with. So could you introduce your company in some words?
My startup is, it's interesting because I just said my startup. My firm is kind of a startup. I created my firm about 5 years ago. It's cross-border. Okay. It's New York and Paris. I have the New York and Paris bars. And what we do is we create companies for the startups, and then we help them. I work for innovative companies.
Okay.
So we help protect their intellectual property. We draft all their commercial contracts. We help them negotiate what they have litigation. We help them with that as well, cross-border. So I help them also with their go-to-market in the US and sometimes in other countries as well.
So you support startups in their international development, especially in the United States.
Yeah.
What could you say about the French startups' international orientation?
I think we have a very good basis here with French startups. First of all, I think it's a very dynamic market. And a lot of them are going international. It depends on where they want to go. I mean, there's not like one specific country. I have a lot of them that want to go into the US, but also because that's my expertise. But I also have startups that go to many different countries. England, I have one in Portugal, Germany, Morocco, and many other countries. It actually depends on their business model, what they want to do, what opportunities they have, where do the shareholders come from, the cost involved with what they want to do. So it's not like one country per se, but they're definitely very dynamic and they all want to expand internationally. But where exactly, it's a case-by-case scenario.
So there are no students' tendencies nowadays in Europe and France?
I mean, if there's a tendency, then I wouldn't know it, because obviously most of the startups that come to see me want to go to the US, right?
Of course.
Because that's what I do. But I do have a number that go pretty much everywhere in Europe and different countries. For me, it's more of a, I don't know if there's, statistically speaking, I'm sure there's like a tendency, but from my perspective, it's really a question of point of view and what they want to do with their startups and the actual opportunities that they have the first few years that they grow and where they find their investors. That's also something that's very important. Yeah.
Of course. So you're also a lecturer at HEC Paris and Sciences Po Paris. In your opinion, do you think that French academic institutions put enough emphasis on entrepreneurship? And what are the main students' tendencies in terms of entrepreneurship in France?
do academic institutions put enough emphasis? I mean, from my perspective, yes, because I teach at HEC and Sciences Po, and I'm starting at Polytechnique, and I teach also at incubators. So for me, this is the academic institutions have really gotten the memo that entrepreneurship is very important. And more, they're actually creating synergies and partnerships between them so that the students can actually meet each other. For instance, commercial students will meet engineering students and development students, so that's very important. So I think they've all gotten the memo. It's very, it's an exciting market to be in France right now. As far as tendencies, again, from a statistic point of view, from my firm, it's hard to say because it's very varied. But I have a lot of e-commerce. I have a lot of connected object, Internet of Things. I have a few in e-health.
Of course.
Exactly. I have a few in food industry. There are a lot of new economic models, e-commerce and food industry, or delivery. So it's very fun. A lot of data issues so involved with that. But it's very varied, and that's what makes it exciting. It's also because in my firm we get to see a little bit of everything that's going on in the world and what's going to create the companies of tomorrow. So that's really fun. Yeah,
I can imagine. So you just mentioned digital and information technology fields that are really very popular between the among the startups nowadays. And so, in your opinion, what would be one main aspect that they must take into account in terms of business law before launching their activity, if we speak about the digital field, for example?
Yeah, well, if you're talking about digital industry, the main question that they have to think about is data and the data issues. And I think the difference between, and that's what the law comes in and is very important. Sometimes the law is here just to help and create value. But if you're in the digital industry, data is more than that. You actually have to work with the law and the regulations and work it into your economic model. So that's very important, especially if your whole business is concentrated on data, which I see is more and more the case with my startups. Their entire economic model is turned around that, then you cannot wait a year down the road to figure out what it is that you can or cannot do. And especially because things are changing a lot and the regulations are changing. So you have to make sure that what you intend to do with your data, whether it's scraping or collecting data in any way, you have to make sure that you're not working too much in the gray zone and you're actually figuring it out first before launching your product or your service. So that's something we're trying to do, and very, very important for international startups as well to take that into consideration. Yeah.
Okay, so, and one more question. We know that there are a lot of French startups that dream to go to the United States and to learn something there.
Yeah.
Do you think that US startups have something to learn in France?
Oh, that's an interesting question. Well, I think actually they do, and they do that. I mean, if you look at, for instance, HEC and other schools have programs where they stand, where they get international students from the US or other countries who come here just to study entrepreneurship and what goes around it, even if those startups don't intend on launching their product or service in the French market, but just because the industry is so vibrant and there's so much to learn, and France is a great country for research and development. There's a lot of creation. I think internationally people actually know that more and more. So, and that's why international investors are less and less scared, in spite of the economy sometimes. They do invest in French companies just because they actually know that. And sometimes you have startups that are in many different countries, and the research and development is actually in France. So that's, yeah.
And so what would be the main difference between the US model and the French model?
I would say an example, if you in the favor of the US, if I can give one point to the US for that. I feel like when you start, when you have a startup in the US, your goal is kind of to change the world. That's the question of, that's the US mentality. And you're not so much afraid of failure as well. And the investors are not scared as well. They will invest more. So you can get three times as much for exactly the same startup as you would get in France, because people are not scared of taking risks and they want to change the world. So it's kind of a different approach. Here, sometimes French entrepreneurs, they tend to think that as long as they raise funds, it means they're successful. So raising funds is a sign of success. In the US, a little bit less. Success is what you make of your product and your service, not so much raising funds. So I would give 1 point to the US for that, although, again, it's a case-by-case scenario, so yeah.
Okay, so thank you very much for being with us today, and I hope to see you soon again.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.